Yes, Joseph, welcome to the TEDx stage. We appreciate that you're here, even though you have a busy week ahead with the Art Basel, the world's biggest art fair. Can you explain us what is the difference between a museum and the Art Basel?
The Art Basel is kind of an art fair. There, it's the marketplace for art. So art is being sold, art is being shown, presented. Museums do almost the opposite. They kind of take art out of the context of the marketplace. They put it into museums where it will be there forever and be stored for future generations. So it's almost the opposite, but of course it's always about art.
Can you explain us, for us as non-experts, there are many artworks we don't understand. Sometimes we are not even sure if an installation is art or not. We have actually a picture brought with us. Can you explain to us why is this art that we see now?
This is funny because this was shown at one of the art fairs, maybe in 2012. And it is really a work of art, and you would probably understand it immediately because, you know, go to the art fair and you're supposed to see art. But what is interesting with this was this is only one part. It was a neon sculpture with that word, voltage, but the was switching between two worlds, one words. One was voltage, the other one was revolt. So it's like an overlapping of two words. And you would see both at the same time, switching back and forth. So I think visitors would understand that this is probably art. This was maybe shown in 2012 or so, you know, the Arab Spring and upheavals all over the world and sort of youth being very concerned about our world. So this is, by the way, by an Indian group of young artists from India. I think they're called Rock Media Collective. And so I think you would have understood that this is art.
So you say it's a question of message, but I've brought another picture, which is just random from the internet. We see it now, fresh hot buns. You see, this has also a message. So why is this not art?
This is really a neon sign, same kind of technology to tell you, We give you food. We sell food. And probably fast food, I would think. And I like it because it's what you see all over the world and maybe low-key neighborhoods. And this is a bun, so probably hot dog or something. And it does have this message, but it's not. You know, it just tells you this is what we sell. That's kind of the difference between art. Art doesn't want to sell itself like that. It sort of wants to open up a space to maybe understand, you know, revolt and voltage, kind of dangerous. You know, the voltage is really, really dangerous. It's high electricity. Revolt, we kind of understand that this is not, you know, this is serious. If people revolt, they have problems and they express themselves. So this is a neon sign, consumer culture, you know. But it does relate to art because artists have taken up exactly that technology and they use it. Like we have at the Kunstmuseum Basel, we have two very famous works by an artist, Bruce Naumann, who uses exactly this technology, also switching different light colors of the neon, and about work that is sort of disturbing and strong, you know, and tells you something about the world.
I see. Good explanations. I have a new challenge for you, the next picture. Well, there you could actually say this is just a pile of old steel. Why is this art?
Well, if you look at it more carefully, you can see this is not cheaply done. You know, this probably cost a lot of money. It's steel, it's carefully formed, it's kind of carefully composed. It's shown in a sort of manipulated space, a park, so it's not wild nature. It's a public park, probably. Don't know exactly where that is. It's a French artist who does these public sculptures. So, I think these are almost like the three different types of what could be considered art or not.
So when I go to a museum, sometimes I feel like everyone around knows more than me. Everyone looks competent, talks about all these pictures, and me, I feel like, okay, I'm not understanding it. Do you understand that feeling, you as a museum director?
Of course, yes. And I think it's a, And it's, I think it's a good feeling. That's where it starts, you know. And me myself, sometimes I'm
even
kind
you?
Of looking at stuff, and I think, what is this? Is this? It's sometimes not so successful. Maybe sometimes it is, and I'm stupid. But so no, I do completely understand that, and I think it's totally legitimate to not understand. You know, Van Gogh, no one thought that this was even worth anything when he lived. You know, no one wanted to buy a single thing. And now people are crazy about seeing works by Van Gogh. So I think as a sort of a beginning attitude, totally fine.
So as we said, next week is Art Basel. Perhaps you can help us a bit. You have brought the picture of Picasso. Perhaps you can tell us a bit or help us to understand this picture. How could we approach this artwork?
I think, you know, art has to do with our world. And I think we live in a very interdependent world. We can't deny that, you know, we are interconnected completely. Our planet is totally interconnected. We destroy, you know, the water, we'll destroy the planet, and on and on. I think what touches me about this painting, which is part of probably one of the most famous paintings at the Kunstmuseum Basel's collection by Picasso, is exactly that. You know, this shows you how fragile things can be. So look at this boy carrying his brother, it's called The Two Brothers, on his back. He's naked, you know, no one knows where he's going. Well, I should ask you, how would you describe this thing?
Yeah, what is obvious that there is actually no room, so we cannot say where it is. You think that there was the aim that we have to figure out where they are?
I think that's a great question, because yes, I mean, obviously it's not defined. The pictorial space, you know, is kind of empty, and that makes it kind of timeless, I think. And also there are no clothes, you know, you couldn't say this is the fashion of 1930 or so. There's no fashion. So it's just these two naked boys. And one looks at you very intensively, and then there is his brother. And if you look at the face of this brother, this baby, it's very beautiful, because it's almost only hinted at. It's almost as if the baby would not have been born yet, because it's not defined at all. Does it belong to the background of the painting? Does it belong to his brother? And yet the brother steps forward, you know, and it's very fragile. It's very vulnerable. It's very human. It's a totally human work here. You don't have to belong to any religion or any period almost. I think you can get what this is, because we all have seen it. You know, a mother carrying around her baby, or a father, or a brother, and this is exactly what's happening here. And I think it's very beautiful.
You also see, you said it's timeliness, the timeliness of the picture you mentioned. Do you think there is a link to today, a very current one?
I started only a few months ago at the Kunstmuseum Basel as director, and after a few weeks, I saw this, if we can show the next, I saw this photograph of, you know, something we have seen many, many times. Look at this. I mean, there are two fathers, perhaps older brothers, men, carrying away two babies, basically very young babies, very vulnerable. And, you know, it's a scene of war, it's a rubble scene, it's destruction all around. And you have this amazing kind of photograph that is, and when I saw this, I thought, wow, this is Picasso. It is exactly the same thing. And so I thought, when we discussed this, we should show this, because in a way, migration has always existed since humans existed. You know, this brother with his this older brother with his younger brother on his back, he steps, we don't know where, but he steps somewhere. And look at where they step here. They really try to get out to protect these very, very, you know, very precious babies. And I think art is about that.
It's a very strong picture indeed. So you also brought the second piece of Picasso. Let's switch to that one. What can we see there?
Yes, well, apparently the family seems to have grown. This is a work from the same year. It, by the way, both of them, you know, with this kind of rose background, they're part of this rose period that is famous in Picasso's life, after the blue period, which was very melancholic and very depressed. This is a more sort of positive or more optimistic short period. And this is a very personal thing for Picasso, and we also have it at the Kunstmuseum Basel. It's an amazing work because of the story, and we'll talk about that maybe a little bit. But look at this. So, okay, so the baby is there, definitely. Now the eyes are kind of more defined. The baby is actually the only one looking out from the picture, looking at us. There is this man behind the baby, the boy. We can assume it's a boy, and a woman carrying the baby. This is a very, very personal portrait of Picasso at the time. He had a lover, Fernande Olivier. She is the one represented here, and they had a very strong wish, or she had a very strong wish to have a child, which never happened. So I believe this is actually a very personal portrait of some very personal thing between Picasso and Fernand. And by the way, he never showed it during the whole life of Fernand. When she died in 1966, and only after she died did he show it for the first time. And he gave it to the Kunstmuseum Basel, which is an amazing story.
So we talked about the individual access to artworks. Is there also a way how pieces can have a meaning for a whole group, for example?
Of course, I think this is like the core unit of a group. No, this is the family, the core family. This is a family. It's a man and a woman, and it's a baby, a woman and a man in a way, and so this is kind of the core of society. So I believe. And art would not even exist without us looking at it. Art kind of tries to activate you as a viewer. It only comes to life when you actually even look at it and react to it and maybe question it. So I think, yes, there is, this idea of we live in a totally interdependent world. We the connectedness of us as human beings is what has always kind of fueled art, what has always pushed art forward. Often artists reacted against sort of what was happening because it was revolting, it was outrageous, what happened in fascism or in the 30s with Hitler coming and putting artists into prisons and all of that. So art has always been sort of at the forefront of what was coming and what the concerns of people were.
Especially this picture has moved many people in Basel, actually, with the Bettlerfest. Could you tell us a bit more about it?
Yes, so of course there was this, so you see here two young kids, two students probably, painting, doing a street painting of that first painting we looked at, the two brothers. Now, what happened is an amazing, beautiful story between Picasso and Basel, that in 1967, the owner of that work by Picasso, this one, the two brothers, he had deposited it, his family had deposited it for many decades. People didn't even know that the museum was not the owner of that painting. But then there was a business tragedy happening for that owner. He lost a lot of money, and in order to not go bankrupt, he had to sell works. And he came to the museum and said, I need to get this back and I need to sell it, and another one. And the museum's director was very concerned, and the public immediately found out. And then the director went to the government and said, can you help us to keep these works here? We need to pay for them, so he doesn't have to sell them. Then there was a group of people in Basel who said money should not be spent like that, so they were against the government spending money for art. So it had to be a public vote, and the public vote was prepared. A lot of young people, like these two boys here, these two students here, and many, many others, old and young, kind of went to the street. It was a huge grassroots movement in Basel to save the two Picassos for the museum, to buy them. And Picasso, it was actually an international story. And then the vote happened, and 63% or so of the Basel population voted to spend the money for that. That was very unusual, And so Picasso was so moved that he donated four more works, among them this very private, very personal painting. That's why they both ended up being permanently part of the museum's collection.
It sounds like an incredible movement. Today, I feel like we don't have these strong movements. Has art lost some of its power somehow?
I don't think art has lost it, but we live in a world, we are totally overcrowded with stuff. We all live with these things here. We are overwhelmed with pictures, with sound, with information, with basically you're constantly bombarded with doing this and that and consuming this and buying that. So I believe we live in a very, very over distracted period. And therefore, we don't have time to do what we sometimes want to do even. But I think that's what art can actually give us. And even, especially now in a time when the art fair attracts even more, nervous people who really want to buy that and spend a lot of money on this and they're very worried that someone else buys this before them. They should go to the museum and relax and look at things like that.
So is this... So is this your striking argument? Because now we hear many interesting things how to approach art, but now it's June, beautiful weather outside, if I have now the choice for going out into a park or jogging or going into a museum. So what is your striking argument for me to visit your museum?
A little hard today, but I think you should do both. You should take a swim in the river and or go to a park, but you should also have a drink and go to the Kunstmuseum. We have a place and refresh and then go and give yourself the dessert of looking at some stuff that maybe gives you some free space, Because, we have things, museums have things that are very, very old. Most of the time we don't realize that most art, like everything else, has been destroyed. We move forward in history, most art has been destroyed. But what is there is all the more important, all the more precious. And this thing, it says something about us as human species, what is important for us, maybe what even, especially in a time of stress and enormous speed, which we live in, art is kind of offers you this kind of oasis and maybe this kind of free space that's not predefined and sort of where you become just a victim of more commercialized stuff going on.
So if you summarize, if you would like us to remember one thing from this talk, what would that be?
I think I'm going back to the beginning, we live in an interconnected, in an interdependent world. We are together. This is our planet. This is, ecology actually comes from the Greek word oikos. Oikos is a Greek, it means household. So our planet is our household. And art is part of that household, is part of that kind of big thing that, it's not so big. The Earth is very vulnerable. If we destroy it, we don't know what will happen, but we are really in trouble. So I think art makes us sensitive for these kinds of connections, for that kind of interdependency, for the maybe the vulnerability of what our lives are about and what the planet and our reality is about.
Josef, thanks a lot for sharing your ideas and your thoughts.
Thank you.